All right, welcome back. The true believers are still with me on the play here. God, this hand's so good, so close to being good. This is a Chromox, right? Yeah, the nice thing is, like Chromox requires you to have an extra land, so you count it as a spell. Whereas Chromox requires you to have an extra spell, so you can fit into a land slot. We're gonna mull this to six. Jeez. All right. I see where you're going, Dang. I see. I probably slided you somewhere. Okay. All right. Guess we're keeping this. The scry is really irrelevant with this hand because we're going to be detutoring for probably Bob. Pretty sure I'm the play. Yeah. Opponent also mulled once. Bet he's not gonna lead off with Mox Diamond though. Bitter Blossom maybe safer than Bob. I think Bob has a higher top end though. There's a lot of draws the opponent could have that just beat a Bitter Blossom. Like they just play some large creatures. Whereas if Bob starts flipping, then just makes up for all the mulligans. Eventually. Give me that land. Okay. What should we lead with? Bob plays around Daze. Rather not have him dazed. This card's like Daze, Force of Will, Mana Tithe. I don't know if Force Spike is in the format. Bob's a little bit better with Mother of Runes, if we can actually untap with the Mother. Because then even if he draws an answer, it's not good enough. Bitter Blossom, not as good with Mother of Runes, I guess. That's what I'm getting at. End of turn, fetch for basic forest. Not what I was expecting. Plains, okay. Plains is a good sign. If white's like his removal color. Jade has a card that we can kind of brick with Mother of Runes too, so that's kind of cool. Yeah, if white's his removal color, then he might just actually be really light on removal. For reveal Batterskull. Because we just played a white mirror, and that accounted for Path to Exile and Source to Plowshares. So it's to like dismember, I guess. You got it, buddy. Would you like to block? He would not. Okay. I understand. We could shock ourselves to hide our last card in hand because we revealed the Godless Shrine to Bob, but it's not really worth it. Turn one, detutor for Bob, working out. I actually got to meet Bob Maher fairly recently. The great one. He's living here in Madison. Impressive figure in the Magic community. Quite a career. Whoa, natural order. Okay, that could throw a wrench into things. It really depends on what his natural order target is I think our current board state could beat a Terastodon, but not like a Progenitus. Okay, cool. I'm gonna set a stop on my upkeep just in case I flip like Vampiric Tutor to my Bob. This is when it dies, right? Yeah, it's the persist thing. Pack Rat reveal, not the most exciting. It is a lot of damage. Definitely want to activate Pack Rat. I'm just deciding whether I want to play my land or not. Like a tapped Godless Shrine or something. Or I guess I would play the Plains. Plains is just a better land than Godless Shrine. It seems like there's no way for these cards to survive. I could trade with the Woodfall Primus in combat. Activate Mutavault. These are both two. Bob is two. Put everyone in front of the Primus. Give, like, I don't know, the Mutavault Pro Green or something. The other option is just to activate Pack Rat. Except that the Jid is going to nuke my board. Try and rat him out. I think this is my best line. It's probably not winning. This guy's actually more awkward to deal with than Terastodon. I mean, Terastodon would have been excellent, like just so much power and toughness to deal with, but because it has trample, there's no way to, for me to prevent it from actually getting Jid counters. At least the cradle only taps for one. If he doesn't sorcery speed the counters, which he might do just to get the Bob off the table, then I kind of like the idea of... Yeah, I really like the idea of waiting till end of turn to activate Pack Rat, in case he removes a counter to try and kill it in response. Then I can activate Mutavault, and all of a sudden he has to use his other counter to kill Pack Rat. Then I get to untap with something of a board. Still not amazing. That'd be a error on his part, though. Yeah, what if he just sorcery speed? Oh my god, he did. Oh, that's insane. Cool. So we tricked him out of a counter. Drew Sword of Light and Shadow. I should actually do the math, because we might have enough here. Like, he doesn't have any Jit counters. So discarding to Pack Rat would make them 3/3s, activating Mutavault makes them 4/4s, 4, 8, 9, 10, 11 exactly. It's probably worth going for, huh? We needed so many things to go right there, only to like waste his counter. We needed... Well, to end this turn. If he doesn't waste his counter, he still doesn't have lethal on his next turn. He only has 6 damage in play, and we're at 7. And he did get rid of Bob, so that wasn't a way for him to close here. He might have been better off like just letting me keep the Bob, because I probably don't have that many answers to a Woodfall Primus anyway. So I have like a random flip towards answering it, but then I'm also probably taking damage. So that's a factor. He could have like gotten a pack rat off the table and could have kept his Jit counters to maybe gain life. That was also an option. Kind of interesting. Okay, seems like a Shriek Bomb matchup. Oh, and a Life Bane zombie matchup. Yeah, we're just going to become a little bit more black for this game 3. Would not like. I like Brain Maggot against a deck that doesn't have very much actual removal. Mom was good. Good against his Jit. I don't think Disenchant is worth bringing in just for Jit. As you saw, we could kind of control it with Mother of Runes there. And then we also have some spot removal. We've got cards like Parallax Wave that can control it. Unexpectedly Absent is like kind of an answer to it already. Yeah, I think it's fine. I mean, obviously can destroy some of my draws, but in general, I think it's okay. I think I can board out this one. Maybe this one. And maybe that one, probably not. But we are raising our curve a little bit. This is tough. Maybe I don't actually want Liliana. So we would just need to make one more cut. Kind of want it to be a 4-drop, a little bit clustered there. Maybe the Amiri Angel, because we're cutting Honor of the Pier anyway. I like that a lot. And then, do we have another black source? I think so. Oh, I actually like that Silverblade Paladin in this matchup. Because it seems to be kind of about racing. And the first strike is another way of turning off Jit. I don't know what I would cut though. Maybe Secure the Wastes. Yeah, I like that. Submit it with a casual 2 seconds left on the clock, as you do. As you do. Okay. Yeah, alright. We need some land drops, but we already have the second black source for Lifebane Zombie because it's Durward. Packrat might just win the game on its own. Parallax Wave is obviously very good. Yeah. Kind of a slower hand, but with a lot of upside. If we hit our drops. The Mentor looks kind of bad. Bayou Pass. Just what I was hoping to see. Scrubland. Alright, get out there. Get out there and do your dirty scrub work. The better lands we could have drawn. Well, I guess all of the planes are scrub lands if we play the Urborg. I think one of the questions with this hand is whether we actually activate Packrat on 3 or just like play the Lifebane Zombie. It's our only second turn play, so that much solves itself. Mentor's actually starting to look better. Mox Sapphire. Pinch Mine, sure. Yeah, I think Mentor plays into the Parallax Wave curve, if that's what my draw is going to be. He's down to 2 cards in hand. Lifebane Zombie is a little bit better if we're going to play Silverblade Paladin next turn, because then that just like is a 2-card combo that bricks Vengevine or races it, whatever we want to do. I kind of like playing it now. I can also just trade with Progenitus in hand. Well, that's unfortunate. because there's the natural order, and he's just going to sack Vengevine, get something awesome. I was thinking just, like, trade with Vengevine, and then we're taking a creature out of his hand, so he won't be able to, like, re-trigger the Vengevine very easily. What would have been good? Not having the best luck this game. Who's he talking about? Yeah, he definitely wants to play Natural Order before attacking. Because otherwise he'd just be offering me the trade with the Lifebane. So what's he gonna grab? Probably the Woodfall Primus again. Yeah, because he had the Progenitus in hand. I think he would have won last game if he could have gotten Progenitus. So maybe it was in his hand that game too. Well, this guy's got Intimidate. He can't block it. That's sweet. I think activating Pancrat's better than playing the Mentor here, because there's nothing saying we actually hit our white source to play the Parallax Wave. So activating Pancrat just gets to attack for a lot. Like, if he smacks me for 6 and I go down to 10 and I go end of turn, activate Pancrat, then the Pancrats are attacking for 3 if I then sorcery speed it, so it's 9, 10, 11, 12. Yeah, not sure about that attack. But I also don't know what he drew for the turn. Tangle Warrior, okay. This is actually hard. This one, I guess. I wanna like make a rat in response to the Tangle Warrior, but if I did that, then I would just have to tap down everything. I think I like the idea of smacking him for 5. Ugh, vomit. Tanglewire was such a good draw. So he's gonna hit me for 6. Which means I need to block some amount of it next turn. Yeah, we're just, like, very easily winning this race, I think, if he plays anything that's not Tanglewire. Decision. I need to block at least 3 damage here. Which I think involves like activating. Okay. Yeah, so he's going to get some value out of his Woodfall Primus, for sure. We're actually going to have to kill it to be in this game. So we have to tap 2 things. Packrat's going to die, so I'll probably tap down both these Packrats. Or no, tap down one of these Packrats and a land. I can hit him for 5. He serves the attack. I can ultimate price it. Gets to blow up one of my lands, I untap, evoke Shriekmaw. Win it 1 life. Kind of an interesting game. I'm afraid your Primus must pay the ultimate price. So that's gonna blow up land. That's his only target, so it's gonna get rid of the planes. Yeah. If he plays a creature here, then things get awkward. Oh my god. It's Kytheon too. Vomit. Okay. So we tap Pack Rat. Draw land, of course. Fortunately, the Lifebane zombie has Intimidate. We didn't know, but we could have tapped a swamp here and won the game, because then we would have had two pack rats to attack him, and then Kytheon can only block one, and he takes Xaxes. The problem with that line is that if we don't draw land, we would just lose if we tapped a land there, because then we couldn't actually deal with the Woodfall Primus. So I took the more safe slash conservative line, which I think is correct. We lose to a removal spell, but I think we saw a lot of the removal spells just between the first couple of white decks. We didn't really see much from him last game. He seems to be more of like an aggro ramp combo deck. Oh my god. That's absurd. It's like the filthiest draw ever. Probably the only card in his deck that punishes us that hard. I'd almost rather he just had a removal spell to win on the spot. This feels miserable. How can we win now? Like, he's activating. He has like exactly enough mana to activate. So he's gonna get his counters. Pops our creatures. Well, that sucked. Yeah. I made the right play near the end there, like not counting on ripping and comes into play on tap land. The opponent was hellbent, like he didn't have anything set up for the win next turn, instead of taking the like slightly worse than 50% odds to hit a land. Okay. Well, he gave us more disenchant targets. Mostly in the form of that tap all our guys down. And Andy showed us a mox, and yeah. And of course he already has the Jit. I still like shifting the focus away to being more immediate. That makes sense. All these cards make sense. What are we cutting for disenchant? Still like Brain Maggot. Still like Arbiter. What do I not like? Oh, Mox Diamond. We can cut Mox Diamond because we're on the play. On the draw, it's a little bit better because you're like drawing up to 8 cards, so your odds of having an extra land have been are pretty good. Whereas when you're on the play, you just have one less draw for making your Mox Diamond decisions, so it's a little bit worse. Even though a turn 1 Bob is better on the play, I think it's still a fine cut here. All right, game 3 on the play. Sure. We need like a white source or a power 2 drum. Fox Diamond would actually be pretty good with this hand. I'm actually going to bottom this. It's not even especially good in this matchup because he has a lot of cards that can go over the top of it. The Batterskull. Like, I think Hero Bladehold is probably going to end up being a better card. And like I said, I'd rather hit like a power 2 drop or my second white source or something. Elvish Mystic, Shriek Maw. Yeah, I'm just going to do that. He's got like Gaia's Cradle in his deck and Natural Order, a bunch of stuff that I just don't actually want him ramping into. The Dying Creatures seems good. It's not like getting the Mother of Runes in play this turn does anything for me. Cool. If I can draw a white source next turn, then this will actually be a pretty decent curve. Wow, that hand. Oh my god, look at that hand. Multiple ways of dealing with the Brain Maggot. So he's probably going to kill it. Just like untap and kill it. Sword of Body and Mind is so good. Easily the best sword. Because with a couple hits of it, you can actually just deck people. And then it gives you a board presence too. The protections aren't as good as some of the other ones, but the actual effect in Limited makes it probably the best one. I've seen it picked very high in Rotisserie. I pick it very high in Rotisserie. What am I talking about? I think I take Lightning Strike. Maybe the sword. Just like make sure that he has to do it. Oh no, if we take the sword, then he can play both of these in one turn, and then the mother doesn't get a chance to untap. Well, he can do that anyway. If he hits a red source, he can just like kill the Brain Maggot, kill the mother. Alright, I'm gonna take a sword. And now our game is kind of dependent on whether or not we can draw a white source here. If we do, I'm probably gonna go Hero Blade Hold and then next turn jump it. Cool, Elves of Deep Shadow. Oh, the reason we should have taken a burn spell is so that he goes, like right now he can go burn your Mother of Runes, untap, burn your Brain Maggot. Whereas if we take the burn spell, then if he burns the Mother of Runes, the other burn spell is locked under the maggot. Back grant, perfect. How about that Brain Maggot attack? Cool. Well, that was both of his removal spells. Elf serves. So we have one more turn to draw a white source here. Oh my god. Alright, do we lead with Hero and then play Elspeth next turn, or do we go like Elspeth make a token? Elspeth make a token is actually pretty good. What's his hand? Polycrinos Vengevine Unknown. If we Elspeth make a token, and he goes like Vengevine serve, then we go chomp it on tap, make another token Hero. That's actually not very good. I'm gonna go Hero now. So this turn, his play is probably just Blue-Green-Nose Pass, because it's the card that bricks here the best. And then I think we're going to be holding back Brain Maggot to chump to protect Elspeth. Oh, that's so much better. Is that so much better? 6, 7, 8 damage to him. If we just like Elspeth jump here. The curve is way sicker if we go like Elspeth jump, hero, blade hold, and then we just hit our land next turn, so we can go Spear of Heliod plus ultimate price. This has to just be better though, right? So we want this ability, we want the pump ability to resolve last, so we put it on the stack first. And then our creatures are 2/1s. Pretty much never missed by people that played this deck a lot. Cool, so he has a sort of body and mind in hand again, but he doesn't really have the time to equip it to anything, to like play it and equip it to anything, which is why I didn't mind trading off the Brain Maggot there. Brain Maggot's body has been strangely relevant this game. Vengevine pass. Well, that's not very good against my hand. Cool. That's the match. Yeah, the reason that the ultimate price was such a good card is we can just get the Plucrinus out of the way, and once that happens, the Vengevine just can't actually block anything with the Spear of Heliod out. The soldiers become 3Xs when you're attacking, and the Vengevine itself can't deal with a 4/5. So, yeah. Perfect draw there, that ultimate price. Cool. On to the finals, I guess. Yeah, we're both 2-0. Sweet, see you guys there.